Well, good morning to you, and we'll maybe get continuation of yesterday for those of you who may have stayed up all night long. I know I had a nice sleep last night, went to bed a little early, and glad to be here with you on Up to the Minute. And hey, if you haven't stepped outside, believe it or not, despite all the rumors and the reports, the sun is still shining, and it's a beautiful day right here in Houston, Texas. If you haven't been outside, make sure you step out at least around lunchtime to enjoy it. For the next half hour, though, we've got your HCC News and Information. We'll introduce our guests in just a moment. But first, I want to introduce Brittany Pacheco. Brittany, you know, you always joke around that Wednesdays feel like day three of the hostage situation. Today, I actually do feel like this is a hostage situation. That's what we feel like we're in. So there you go. I'll give it to you today.
Yes. Finally, you've crossed over to the dark side. I said it Monday. We're on level 11. For Jumanji. So,
and it's, you know, 2020. So anything can happen and anything has happened. It's just crazy.
Exactly. No, it is. Last night I tried not watching or even being on social media, but you know, throughout the night it's like, okay, do we have an answer? Do we have an answer? You know what? We're just going to have to take it 1 hour at a time and just wait. Obviously, yeah. I know everyone's on at the edge of their seats rather, but we have a very special show for everyone this morning. But before we get into that, I do want to remind everyone just to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, as well as our YouTube channel. Be sure to subscribe, hit that notification bell so you can be the first to find out the latest uploads from us. And last but not least, to our audience, we specifically need your help. We need your help to share this podcast. That way we can one, grow our audience, but two, just more importantly, share this information to everyone. So Todd, let's get into day three of the hostage situation here on Up to the Minute. Let's welcome our guests.
That's right. Thanks, Brittany. We'll check back in with you in a little while. Chief Greg Cunningham, HCC Police Chief, is joining us this morning. He's here every Wednesday. Good morning, Chief. Did you sleep well last night?
Yeah, I did actually. So we can talk about it a little bit later, but we've been here before where it's taken days and days and days to figure out the results. So when it wasn't a landslide early, I called it a night and I got plenty of rest and I'm ready to go today.
All right, Chief, we're going to be with you in a little while. And I know that if you stick around, the Chief is going to give us a few little election stories and anecdotes. So we'll talk with him about that in a little while. Right now, though, we want to go on out to HCC's Coleman College of Health Sciences. The Dean, Dr. Jeff Gricar, is joining us this morning. Good morning, Dr. Gricar. How are you?
Good morning. I'm doing great. Thank you for having me.
So we've had a number of people from Coleman on, including Dr. Nicotera, your president. Mm-hmm. And we've asked how things have been going with the remote learning. I know back in the spring, things kind of went astray for a lot of your students because they couldn't get in to finish up the semester. You guys worked on that over the summer. And what is the status this semester with getting students back on in a limited fashion?
So we have gotten students back in. We started off completely online. With all of our classes and our labs online. But as the campus opened in October, October 5th, we've been going for about a month now, and we've had really good success. Students are in their laboratory classes, and they are doing well. They're catching up from some of the competencies and skills that they needed to learn from the summer. So we have those students that are on campus. They're continuing with their lectures online. We also have a lot of students that are actually out in the field doing their clinical rotations with the healthcare facilities that are allowing students in at this time. And that's actually quite a few.
And I know that was kind of a challenge for you guys when I talked to Dr. Nicotera going into the summer, getting the students back into the hospital settings and the medical settings, because from what he was saying, they weren't ready for the students to come back yet because of COVID.
Right. There was a lot of hesitation especially at the beginning of summer. So we slowly got students back into clinics. And I would say right now we probably have a good 75 to 80% of our students that are able to do a clinic, that they're doing clinic in some shape, form or fashion, whether it's actually at the healthcare facility, or we have some students that are doing some alternative learning methods that still get them to those competency levels that they need to be at.
And one of the things we've talked about with several people from Coleman over the last few months, especially since COVID hit, is the need for respiratory therapy technicians and assistants. Because of COVID and breathing problems that people have, it seems like these positions are in high demand right now, or they're going to be in the next couple of years.
Yeah, they're definitely in high demand right now. You know, they are right on the front line with the doctors and the nurses, providing that daily care for COVID patients. And that is one of the groups where we do have, the students are in clinic right now, and they are working in the hospitals with the therapists, learning those skills so that they can get out and provide that help when they graduate.
Let's talk about, for the students who are going into Coleman right now, you've got a beautiful facility there, state of the art, if anyone hasn't been out there yet. It's incredible. But you're doing things a lot differently now. I imagine there are areas people can enter the building and also exit, and you're practicing social distancing, and you've got a number of measures in place.
Absolutely. We have one entrance. So when they enter at the tower building, and if my background, that's our beautiful building, our state-of-the-art building. So they enter in one building and they will exit out the other building going across the skywalk. We have everything's marked off for social distancing. We have hand sanitizing stations. Everyone is required to wear a mask if they enter. They have to do the daily pre-screening. So that all happens. And then we also, as far as our labs, we only allow 10 people per area. So that's usually 9 students and 1 faculty member, so that we can ensure that we can social distance as much as possible. One of the challenges is that with health sciences, a lot of the competencies and skills you have to learn with someone else. So there, when we do that, we keep that number down as low as possible, and they stay in those same groups, so they're not moving from group to group, but we try to keep that social distancing as far as possible. And again, everyone has complete PPE on, masks and face shields and so forth.
But I would imagine with the smaller classes, you really get more one-on-one instruction with the professors.
You do get more one-on-one instruction with the professors. However, it can be a longer day for the students and definitely for the faculty. So if we had 2 lab sections of 20, now we have to have 4 lab sections of, 9 or 10. So that could make the schedules are a little bit different than what they have been in the past. So students may be going on alternate days. We even have some classes that are happening on the weekends because we need to find that extra time to run those smaller lab sections.
Well, you mentioned longer days for the faculty. What's the reaction been from the faculty? I know everyone here at HCC seems like we've all had to be flexible, at least since last March.
Oh, absolutely. The faculty have done a great job at Coleman, starting in the spring and taking those courses and converting them to an online modality. And then as we move back and trying to get as much of the hands-on that they could do, I mean, you can't really do hands-on online, but they have a lot of opportunities to use simulation, and we have some online programs that can be used. But once we got back into campus, they just went full force, and really the faculty were the biggest factor in getting students back on campus, because they wanted students to get on campus. They want students to have that hands-on practice that they need to be successful and graduate and then get out, be a successful practitioner in the workforce.
Jeff, as you move forward and we look towards next semester and beyond, of course, COVID here to stay, at least for the time being, until there's a widely distributed vaccine. But looking into next semester, this online component, do you see it still playing a major role as you move forward with operations at Coleman?
I think it's going to play a big role. I'm not sure it's going to be as big as it is this semester. You know, we're planning to do, to kind of continue on as we're going right now with online lectures and in-person labs. But I think that as we move forward, we've been very successful with having students back on campus. So I think that it's now is going to be the time that we're going to look at trying to start to increase the number of students that we can have in the labs, and maybe start to bring some students back for some lecture if that's a possibility, but also look at those flex campus models where we only maybe have half the students in the lecture class and the other half are online, and they can flip-flop, because students, they like that one-on-one contact with the instructor, and a lot of students want to have that interaction. So that's a really important key to do, even though, like I said, our faculty have been doing a great job online and they've been keeping the students engaged, and a kudos out to them because it's really hard work for them.
And we want to remind everyone, if you're interested in the programs at Coleman, we'll put a link to their programs in the social media post for the show. And registration for next semester, by the way, is going on, folks. You can always visit hccs.edu/now for all your registration needs and get a look at the classes that are going to be offered. Dr. Jeff Gricar, Dean of HCC's Coleman College of Health Sciences, thanks for being here this morning. Stay safe out there.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
Absolutely. Now we're going to move on to the chief. Of course, Chief Greg Cunningham joins us every Wednesday morning on the show for a regular segment. Chief, so this is the day after Election Day. We still don't have a decision. We're moving in that direction. You've been around for a while. This is kind of a deja vu as to 20 years ago.
Yeah, it surely is, Todd. this is, you guys all may remember the hanging chads out of Florida. Where it took weeks and weeks, and then after they got what they thought were answers, they ended up going to court and suing one another over it. So that was I mentioned earlier, I looked at it pretty early on, and when it wasn't a landslide, I knew I could go to sleep because it's going to be days now, maybe weeks before we get things going here.
Yeah, it could certainly take a while. And I think, you know, I think this brings back some bad memories because people don't remember. It did take weeks back in 2000, between Gore and Bush to see what would happen there. So we'll just have to wait and see. Want to talk about the after the election, because there's been some troubling pictures and video that's been shared in social media from around the country about certain cities that are boarding up windows preparing for civil unrest.
Yeah, and it's really, really sad and scary that those kind of things are having to happen. We had talked out a long time when we really first started COVID with supporting each other in communication. It's really broken down between the parties and the special interest groups here. I have to be really candid with you. Boarding up windows in businesses after an election is something that we got to put a stop to. And nobody can do that but us, right? I don't care which side of the street you're on here, breaking into a store and stealing their stuff or burning down a facility that somebody has put their heart and life into that employs several people, there is no way you can justify that as being right behavior. So, it breaks my heart to see those businesses boarded up. To their credit, they did it preventative. What I am challenging us is let's not have to do that again. That was ugly, and it's not where we ought to be.
Yeah, I mean, as a country, we're better than that. You know, we just have to move forward. And we've always talked about on this show about the conversations that need to be had across the country. And last week we were discussing those conversations haven't taken place. And maybe that's where we are right now.
Yeah, people are talking about getting them started, but everybody is still so entrenched that no one is able to hear yet. We're still shouting at each other. Our positions as opposed to having the conversation and the give and take back and forth. I think I'm hoping the election results, when it's finally said and done, will allow us to take that next step and come out of those trenches and begin to have some meaningful conversations, because we got to learn how to work this thing out. If all we're going to do is dig in and shout at each other, we're not going anywhere for a long time. And none of us has an interest in making that happen.
I want to talk, Chief, about some historical facts, somewhat fun facts. And this is the first thing we're going to talk about is something everyone who's a history buff will probably remember seeing the picture of Truman holding up a newspaper that says Dewey defeats Truman. And that was shared across the country and still is an iconic photo about how the media got it wrong.
Absolutely, right, and it speaks to exactly what we're going through today, right? We all know that popular vote is important, but the real deal here is the Electoral College, and again, it was November 3rd, 1948, in fact, everybody got impatient waiting, and the media went ahead and they printed the Dewey defeats Truman banner. And it was just stone cold wrong. And it took them 24 to 48 hours to figure it out. And the Chicago Tribune has been embarrassed by that one for a long, long time.
And it seems like every election, they're embarrassed every election cycle because that picture is brought up. And nowadays, they just get shared in social media. First medical school for women opened in Boston in 1848.
Absolutely. So just kind of some fun facts for the first week of November. Until 1848, while women were obviously playing a giant role in medical care, the first medical school opened in Boston. The interesting part is it was an all-female school because back then you had men and women's schools, right? And there were only 12 students when they opened up that institution. But that's an interesting fact. And for our Coleman friends that are watching from our presentation today, that's one to carry away. In 1874, that medical school merged with Boston University Medical School. And that was one of the first co-ed colleges in the nation at that time. So a couple hundred years ago is when it all started, right?
Well, Chief, I also, you know, one of the troubling things about the first week in November, you know, it was before I was born, but back in 1962, I don't think people, well, I guess if you're around back then, you do realize how close we were to a possible nuclear war with the Soviets because of the missile crisis in Cuba.
So, Todd, the fact that you said you weren't born yet was really uncalled for because I absolutely was, and I was there, okay? Brittany did that to me last week. You got me this week.
Sorry, Chiefs.
So, for anybody that doesn't know about it, it was a really, really very tense time. You know, we were in the Cold War, and the U.S. and Russia were arguing with each other. Well, Russia had moved nuclear missiles onto the island of Cuba. And for those of you that know that part of the world, that's only 90 miles off of Key West, Florida, right? So they don't get much closer than that without being on U.S. dirt. And it was really, really a tough time. But November 2nd, 1962, was when it finally got resolved. And the Russians agreed to take their missiles off of Cuba. And over the next couple of weeks, that actually happened. I think by Christmas time, it was all done.
Also a fun fact, and I don't want to disappoint you here either, Chief, but I wasn't around when this happened in 1922. Wasn't born yet, okay? November 4th, King Tut's tomb was discovered.
Well, absolutely. Now, I'll be honest with you, I wasn't born either. But, see, everybody thought that Luxor was in Las Vegas. It's actually in Egypt, and it is where King Tut is. And on November 4th of 1922 is when they found that tomb, and they I'm not positive if that's when they determined it was his or if that's when they discovered the site, but that's when this thing all unfolded. And of course, then it all went to Las Vegas, and we have the Luxor in Vegas, and everything is good now.
It's all good now. Another important fact: Carl Stokes became the first African American mayor on November 7th back in 67.
So that's absolutely correct, right? Again, we're talking about how far people have come and how quickly they've come. When you start to look at these dates, it's a little terrifying. Carl Stokes was the first African-American mayor in the United States, and it was in Cleveland, Ohio, he was elected. And that did happen in 1967, right? Following up, right? So the first African-American governor was L. Douglas Wilder. And he became the governor of Virginia, and that was in 1989, which is way recent.
That's right.
So those are really benchmark points, and what it says is that while we've come a long way, we need to keep coming, and we need to keep coming quicker, right?
Yeah, we've got a long ways to go, Chief, and it seems like we've got a long ways over. Maybe could be a long next couple of weeks. Who knows how long this could take before this election is resolved and we have a president elected or, you know, announced a winner in this election. Chief Greg Cunningham, it's always a treat to have you here every Wednesday.
Well, thanks, Todd. I really appreciate it. If I can just speak to the crowd for a second, please pack your patience. This thing is going to take a little bit of time. And the reality, folks, is no matter which way this goes, the the system working is the important piece of this thing. And this year, historically, more people have been engaged in this process than I believe have ever been engaged ever. So thank you for that. Thank you for going and voting. And now all we need to do is let's be patient and wait for these results. And then you know what? We're all going to make the best out of this thing anyway, because we always do.
Absolutely. Great words of advice from HCC Police Chief Greg Cunningham. Thanks again, Chief. We'll see you next week.
Take care, guys.
All right. We are going to move on to Brittany. And Brittany, I've got to say, so last night, got home, went out to dinner, got home, and I was good about not watching TV. But usually when I'm watching TV, sitting on the bed, watching Netflix or whatever, I'm scrolling through my phone and going through social media. So I kind of kept up with what was going on in social media. But guess what? You don't get any answers from that either.
Oh, yeah, no. It's, I think aside from watching television, social media is like the next worst thing in this scenario with trying to get information, because obviously people have very strong opinions and they obviously support one over the other. And so it's kind of hard to really have a clear picture of what's going on, but that's okay. As Chief said, this is going to take a while. And while some people's anxiety has been triggered, I know mine has been triggered somewhat, we just have to breathe, take it day by day. We have to just be patient, pack that patience, as Chief had said, and we'll get there. We'll get there.
One way or another, and believe it or not, no matter what happens today, the sun's going to rise again tomorrow. I'm predicting, I'm calling that today.
You know, I do want to bring up, Todd, because you did mention this, this thing mentioned about this supposed meteor or asteroid or something that was supposed to hit Earth before the election. Like, what happened to that?
Yeah, I saw that in social media, too. I guess we missed that one. Yeah. And there's also an asteroid which is headed our way, but it's not headed towards Earth. It's going to pass by us. But they say it's got so much metal in it, it's worth $1 quadrillion.
I heard about that. Yeah.
I think we're all missing our opportunity. We got to go get that thing and bring it to Earth.
Missed opportunity can be interpreted in many different ways. Anyway, let's move on to the events and announcements here at HCC, starting with our filmmaking series that involves Alfred Cervantes, who is the director of the Houston Film Commission. This is in conjunction with our HCC Visual and Performing Arts COE. Now, this is a free virtual workshop that's happening today at noon until 2 o'clock. Registration is required. You can email michael.cone@hccs.edu to register in order to participate.
You know, I saw a lot of people on social media last night saying, hey, you know, boy, I'm going to need a drink after tonight. And while it's funny to joke about, substance abuse and alcoholism can be a very serious problem for many, especially when we're in the shutdown, because people can come to rely on that to lift their spirits and they can fall in trouble. We've got a council going on, a counseling event, Substance Abuse 101, HCC Northwest Counseling Department presents Lori Feister. She's the clinical director of the Council on Recovery. It's going to be a WebEx session, very important session, so you may want to check it out. That is happening today, Brittany, 2 p.m. Wednesday, November 4th. It is free and open to the public. You don't have to be tied in with HCC to watch this event. Share the link. We'll have it in our social media post with all the information that you need. Project Homeworld virtual talks are going on, Brittany.
That's right. Now, we've been talking about this for quite some time, and we're just a day away from it. So textile waste has grown in over, can you believe it, 800% in the last 50 years, mostly fueled by fast fashion. Have any idea what I'm talking about? Because I certainly don't. But designer and educator Jessica McMahon will discuss innovative new approaches to make a circular economy through creative reuse, upcycling, and a revolution in material science. So this event is The Future of Fashion in Circular, happening tomorrow, Thursday, November 5th from 2 to 3 p.m. To register, simply go to hccs.edu/homeworld-events.
Brittany, I want to talk about some things and move on down to some virtual things that are available to our students right now. One thing I want to let you know is registration for the spring is ongoing. It started on Monday, and now, Brittany, is the right time to register if you want to attend classes in the spring, because we've got four modalities, and if you want to pick the right one, those classes could fill up fast. So now is the time to register.
Absolutely, especially for our students who are on the verge of graduating. We talked to one of our students yesterday who will be graduating in spring 2021. So students, do not hesitate to register for your classes. As Todd said, they are open. They open this week. So be sure to go to our website, hccs.edu/now, to take the appropriate steps in order to register for your classes. Make sure you have your ducks in a row. And if you do have questions, Todd, we have some services available for our students to utilize.
Yeah. So one thing I want to let you know, if you need financial aid is are seeing people in person, but you have to, there's no walk-ins. You have to schedule it ahead of time. So in-person financial aid appointments are available. Go to hccs.edu/financial aid contact. We'll have the link in the social media post. And also virtual house open sessions, Brittany, we can't have those in person because of COVID. So we're having those online as well.
That's right. The virtual open house sessions have been extended until January. So for people who are interested in either starting, continuing, or even just relaunching their educational journey, they can come here to HCC and not have to do that alone. So our enrollment department is here to help along with other departments, but they're gonna talk with new students and parents and school counselors. So you can check the site about these sessions. You can go to hccs.edu/informationsessions. Again, they're going to cover admissions application, financial aid, orientation, advising, and much, much more.
Students, if you've got questions on textbooks, tutoring, all those things can be, we've addressed them in an online toolbook for you. It's an online services toolkit. You can download it at hccs.edu/online-toolkit. Get all your answers there. And our student virtual lobby is open, Brittany. Very easy to find.
Very easy to find, Todd. If you want to get in touch with someone from our institution through Zoom, a callback, or even email, the student virtual lobby is the way to go because no appointment is necessary. And we do have extended hours Monday through Friday, even Saturdays. So head to hccs.edu/virtual lobby in order to utilize this resource today.
Well, we're also having virtual college transfer fairs. Remember the days, I know back when I worked at the Southwest College, the Stafford campus used to always have these transfer fairs, and colleges and universities would show up, they'd set up a table, and hundreds of students would go into the learning hub where they could meet with representatives from each university. They could get their questions answered, pick up some flyers on the college of their choice or where they may like to transfer, and get their questions answered. So we're doing that virtually this year, and we've got a number of colleges from Prairie View A&M to the University of State Thomas, U of H, UT, Texas A&M, many more. They're going to be available to answer your questions online in a virtual format. You can get information on that and when they appear. And if you miss them live, you can also watch the rebroadcast. Go to hccs.edu/transferfair. If you're having trouble connecting to the internet, we've got a solution, Brittany.
We do, Todd. So some students are allowed back into the HCC campuses, but not all. However, if you do need access to the Wi-Fi, we do have a specific parking lot Wi-Fi zones available for students to connect to the internet, or if you just need a quiet place to study, because let's face it, being at home with your loved ones, it can get a little too much. Now, utilizing these parking Wi-Fi zones, you will not have access to the restrooms or the outlets inside the building. So just be sure you come prepared ahead of time. Want to know where you can go to utilize the free parking lot Wi-Fi zones? Head to hccs.edu/outdoorwifi.
So that wraps up the show for today. Tomorrow, we've got former student success story, Shamika Dickerson Pepper of HCC Central. She'll join us to talk about her time here as an art student and what she's been up to since. And Brittany, it's Virtual Family Fun Thursday.
Yeah, and it's going to be a good one considering the status of everyone's mental health during this pandemic. We're going to be welcoming Sean Fitzpatrick, Executive Director of the Young Center. So that'll be a very interesting topic to discuss. Before we head off, Todd, I do want to remind everyone just to follow us on social media. Don't forget to share this podcast, and we'll see you tomorrow morning at 10 a.m. on Up to the Minute.